Good afternoon. Thanks everyone for coming to TreasureLens presentation. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. QT Long.
Thank you, Phil, for inviting me. It's an honor for me to talk at Google, and I'm grateful that you took some time out of your busy day to come and listen to me. I was a more unlikely person than you to photograph the national parks. I was born in Paris from Vietnamese parents, and I grew up as a city kid. My world changed when college friends took me high up the high peaks of the Alps. I discovered wilderness for the first time and made a connection with nature. Here in California, we are very fortunate to have access to many wild places. But in France, they were all gone, save for the high mountains. I took up photography as a means to bring back to friends and family who could not get there the beauty of the high peaks of the Alps. Here, this is Mont Blanc, the highest peak in Western Europe. I was just snapping a quick shot and before hurrying down to beat the storm. At first, my goal was just to document my climbs. But I began to notice that sometimes light could create some magic. A Canadian friend of mine loaned me this book, and I realized that the type of photography that I was doing could be elevated to an art form. This was my last climb in the Alps in the summer of 1992. Beautiful light at sunset. But wait, what were you doing there at sunset when you were supposed to have an alpine start? It was a photo trip. I had begun to learn more about the light, and priorities were changing. This was my last trip in the Alps because the next winter I would move to Berkeley. I would work on the first self-driving car project in California. I just finished my PhD, that's a book that grew out of it, and I was looking for a short-term postdoc stay in the US. At that time, I didn't know much about the geography of this country, but other climbers had told me that there were some good rocks to climb in Yosemite. So of all the great US research universities, I picked up Berkeley because it was the closest to Yosemite. I didn't know anything about the national parks either, but I was told that somewhere in Yosemite there was a 3,000-foot high cliff, the tallest in North America. I discovered there a vertical wilderness at a scale new for me. The climbs took several days to sleep. We had to bring along those platforms, which are called portalages, very comfortable, just have to make sure that you don't roll on your sleep. So I didn't fall out of the portalage, and I managed to snap a few pictures. So the key in climbing photography is that you have to try to be at the same level of the climber or above. In the spring of the same year, the mountain called again, and I set up my sight on Denali, the tallest peak in North America, at 20,000 feet. What makes a climb of Denali special is that it is a combination of mountaineering and Arctic expedition. Temperatures can go down to minus 40. Climbers build snow walls to protect their tents against the fierce wind. You start with supplies for 3 weeks. That's the time it takes to acclimatize, climb the mountain while waiting the storms. It's too heavy to carry on your backpack, so in addition to the backpack, you drag a sled. I didn't freeze to death and made it to the summit. With glaciers extending to the horizon, the immensity of the mountains were at a scale new to me. That same fall, I visited Death Valley. I'd never been in a desert before, so that was also a new environment for me. The geological formation fascinated me. Previously, I was standing on the top of the coldest mountain on Earth, the top of North America. Now I was at the lowest point in the Western Hemisphere, where the hottest temperature on Earth was recorded. I began to realize how much diversity there was in the national parks. I was able to appreciate that because I'd been to both places. Yet there were also similarities. You see here the salt flat echoing the glaciers in the valley. Each park is highly individual and unique, but taken together, they're all interrelated. So I'm a self-taught photographer and learned mostly by reading books and by looking at books of photography. I began to study the American tradition of landscape photography, which is much stronger than in France. I visited local museums, and the prints that I saw were the most beautiful I've ever set my eyes on. When I came back from Denali, I was somehow disappointed by my pictures, so it was time to try a new approach. I decided to try to photograph with the same camera as the old masters, the large format camera. So here's one of the first images I made in Death Valley. When I came home and looked at the transparency, I was astonished to see that there was more detail that I could see than when I was standing at the scene. And to give you, illustrate that with an example from a very different environment, the redwoods of Northern California. If you come between mid-May and mid-June, the rhododendrons are in bloom. They are a very small part of the image, but an important nevertheless because they create the color contrast. With a large format camera, I do not have to frame tightly the blooms for the detail to be there because there is so much resolution. A second example here to show you that in those images, I do not have to direct the viewer because there is so much detail that they can explore the image for themselves, as if they were standing at the scene. So here are a few details from that image. Each of them makes an interesting nature picture of its own. And second technical detail is that you can notice that the trees in the background are as sharp as the reeds in the foreground. So the second technical detail, the horizon here is fairly low in the image, yet you see the trees remain parallel. And there, in the redwood scene, the horizon was low and we have parallel trees. If we had converging trees, as would have happened if I'd pointed the camera up, that would create a different mood for the picture with less of a sense of calm. So the large format camera has bellows that connect the front and the back, and that allows me to include tall objects between without pointing the camera up, and that meant what maintains the parallelism. So here, the second adjustment that you have is the tilt. So the tilt allows you to change the plane of focus. With the regular camera, that plane is a vertical plane, which means that the focus at a fixed distance, either foreground or background. Here, I was able to choose as a plane of focus, a plane that goes from the ridge to the hill, and therefore maintaining everything sharp. So those movements are available in a limited way with tilt and shift lenses, but what's unique to the large format camera is the size of the negative. So here you see the back of my camera, it's 5x7. That's the exact size of the negative. Here you see a transparency there. So this transparency is 5x7. It is 5 times in linear dimension, the size of 35 mil or full frame, 25 times in surface area. That's what gives the detail and provides large format photography its descriptive power. So when you photograph, you have to use a dark cloth because the image on the ground glass is very dim. Everything is manual, not only focus, exposure, but also film transport. So there's many occasions to mess up. So each holder holds 2 pieces of film, one on each side. So you insert it on the camera. When you're ready to make the exposure, you have to remove the dark slide so that the film can be exposed. And then you have to be careful not to double expose it, since there's two of them. So in order to do that, you put the dark side in reverse, so you remember which side you've exposed. So with all the time it takes to set up an image, it doesn't make sense just to shoot one without backup. So in general, I shoot two pictures for the same composition. With the cost of film and processing labs, it adds up to $20. So here's a picture. It was taken in the Tetons in winter. This type of photography promotes a very deliberate approach. This helps me communicate how the land reveals itself to a viewer in a state of heightened awareness. So I've been talking quite a bit about large format photography, but the discipline that I learned can be transferred to other equipment as well. If you slow down, that would be the thing that will do the most to help your photography. And you can maybe pretend that your camera is very heavy and cumbersome if it helps. Those two strengths, my desire to see the diversity of the national park and large format photography, inspired me to embark on a project to photograph each of them in large format. So we have currently 60 national parks. 9 of them are located in California. Have you visited, any of you visited each of them? I'm to give you a quick tour of them, and since it's a tech talk, it will be maybe a few photo tips. Tunnel view is maybe the most accessible viewpoint in the national parks. It was made famous by Ansel Adams. I conceive this image as an homage to Ansel Adams because he'd photographed it so many times. But I wanted to make something that he hadn't made there at that location, which is an image which would work only in color and not in black and white. So I envision the maximum color contrast that would happen with the orange of sunset in the cloud and the blue fog in the valley. And this was the image that I visualized. It took me dozens of visits, but eventually I made it happen. So that's the power of pre-visualization for you. Lassen Volcanic National Park. So for this image, I photograph at sunrise. The more specific the moment, the more universal the image. I had to photograph right at that moment because after the sun would come out, the shadows would ruin the foreground. And I use a graduated neutral density filter to control the brightness of the horizon. Joshua Tree National Park. So beginners are often told to photograph with the sun on their back, but here, that's the backlight that makes the image work. It's a very interesting light. It makes the spine of the cacti glow. Those cacti are called the jumping chola cactus, and they're not called that for nothing. When I was there fumbling in the dark, I brushed against one of them. I didn't want to try to dislodge it for fear of getting my fingers stuck as well. So with the sunrise quickly approaching, I kept photographing with one lodge in my behind. So only after it was all over, I strolled back to my car and teased the spanning thing out with pliers. But the best tool for that is a comb. And my advice to you is to carry one when you hike in the desert. Pinnacles National Park. The 59th National Park, it was designated in 2013. The next day, after it became a national park, I came at dawn so that I would be sure that I'd be the first to photograph the 59. But this image is taken at dusk. Often photographers leave right after the sun has set. It's too early. The best light often comes after sunset. So you have to stay until it is dark, but make sure that you bring a light. Redwood National Park. So the smaller subject needs softer light. larger subject needs stronger light. So for the forest, often overcast is the best light. But even so, it wouldn't be enough here because the tops of the trees would have been too bright. So what makes the picture work here is the fog. It conveys a sense of depth and mystery. So try to seek weather conditions. Kings Canyon National Park. So unlike the redwoods, the sequoias are mountain trees. I wanted to convey that by shooting them in the snow. The first time I came, so there was no snow on the trees and the scene didn't have a wintry atmosphere. So I came back a second time, right after a storm, but as the sun came up, the snow started to fall from the branches. I drove back home 6 hours without making a single large format photograph. The third time, I came right during the storm, wearing full mountaineering gear and using snowshoes. I was able at least to get the image, so persistence pays. Sequoia National Park, the sister of Kings Canyon. You see here a very similar subject to the previous one, the base of sequoia trees, very similar composition, but the mood is very different. In photography, light is everything. So the light that you're seeing here is the light that I talked about before, after sunset, before it gets dark. It's a very beautiful light for that scene because it is at the same time soft, so no hard shadows, and directional, reveals the texture. Channel Island National Parks, a set of 5 islands. The closest is only 1 hour off the coast of Southern California, but it could be a world apart. They are home to plants which are found nowhere else on the planet, such as the giant coreopsis. So this viewpoint is, in my opinion, the best view on the whole west coast, but it is more beautiful if you come when the flower is blooming. At other times, everything is brown, like the rest of California. So for trips, if you want to see the best of nature, it is always important to research and try to time your trip. Death Valley National Park again. So maybe you've noticed, but this is the 5th image of Death Valley that I show you, and all of them were taken in midday. So midday is possibly the most difficult time to photograph a landscape, and particularly the desert. So how did I make that work? So I looked for a dune which had a steep slope, which was grazed by the sun. I shot backlit to accentuate the texture. So in the back, there's those mountains whose textures echo that of the dunes, but yet they are darker. So they don't draw the eye away from the dunes. And for the same reason, I excluded the sky because it would have been brighter and draw your eye away. So beyond California, we have many national parks. There's a total of 60 of them. Here's Orlastus that I photographed 2 weeks ago. The national parks extend from the southern hemisphere. So this is our southernmost national park, American Samoa, to north of the Arctic Circle. This is our northernmost national park, Gates of the Arctic National Park. So like many of the Alaskan national parks, there is no roads or even trails. When I made this image, I took advantage of a 5-minute window during which the clouds lifted. For the rest of my stay, they would not lift again. To get there, I flew from the Bay Area to Anchorage and then to Fairbanks. In Fairbanks, I took a commuter plane to reach Beatles, a community which can be reached only by plane in the summer. And there, we chartered a plane to land us on a lake. And we backpacked for 2.5 days to arrive at the base of the peak. So to show you a few more behind of scenes from my Alaskan trips. So this scene looks also very wild, but actually it is the best place for you to walk on the glacier. It is only 1 hour from a road. It is in Wrangell-St. Elias National Park, which is our largest national park. It is the size of 6 Yellowstone. I wanted to convey the immensity of the place and of the mountain. And for that, I needed a higher viewpoint, which I sought by climbing the mountain that you see on the right. So that's me with a backpack typical of Alaskan trips. So I have my backcountry camping gear, my 5x7 camera, and a 35 mil system too. It adds up to 70 pounds. The glacier looks flat from a distance, but it is full of nooks and crannies, such as this canyon carved by a glacier stream. You can even go down under the glacier if you're a relatively fit hiker, even without experience in mountaineering. Local guides can take you on a half-day trip there. So the crossing the glacier was only a few miles, but it took me the whole day because I had to zigzag between crevasses. The next day, after setting up my camp at the base of the mountain, I planned to climb the mountain as a day trip. But in the afternoon, it turned out that it was too hazy because of distant forest fires and the light wasn't very good. So I resolved to bivvy on the top of the mountain without my climbing gear. But fortunately, I had my stove, so I was able to make myself some warm tea before going to bed for a very cold night. So the next morning, I got my second chance. So here's a picture. Was it worth it? Glacier Bay National Park. So far, to explore the national park, I'd used mostly my mountaineering skills. But Glacier Bay is a marine wilderness. When Captain George Vancouver sailed there 200 years ago, that very spot was a solid sheet of ice. 200 years later, the glaciers have retreated 65 miles, which is the largest glacial retreat in history. So to explore those parks, I had to learn new skills in the case of Glacier Bay paddling. The glacier that you see in the background looks small, but our kayak here give you a better indication of its scale. The National Park Service has done a great job at helping us explore the parks, and even at such a remote location as Glacier Bay, they provide a shuttle boat, and so it transports you midway, so you have to paddle only 30 miles to the glaciers. So this was a trip in which we packed for 2 weeks, and believe it or not, all this stuff fits into a double kayak. Everything was wrapped into plastic bags because it had been drizzling all morning. Usually I travel solo by myself, but for that trip, I was very fortunate to have found a partner, and actually I retreated him at a slide presentation just like this one. So come to see me if you want to take a trip. And I was fortunate to have him because the tides in Glacier Bay are so strong that if I was by myself, I might have been swept away. So we started very early in the morning. We had planned to paddle until it got dark, but it was Alaska and it was mid-May. So we ended up setting our camp past midnight. And by the time we were done, I noticed that the light was getting brighter. So I didn't want to go to bed. It was so beautiful. I strolled down and I saw an iceberg which was 100 feet out in the water. I knew that at the speed at which the tide was moving, it would be soon out of the water. So I walked in water until I was knee deep. I set up the camera and I was able to make this image just as the tide line was reaching it. So this was on the first day of my trip, but it still remains my favorite image of that trip because it reminds me of that particular state of mind I was after being awake for 24 hours. So on our way to Kobuk Valley National Park, our most remote and least visited national park, the year when we visited, Kobuk Valley saw 4,000 visitors. By contrast, Yosemite had 4 million. Eskimo village downstream of the park and take off through another mail plane. But we thought it would be a leisurely float, but the river was very placid, and from time to time, when the wind blows hard, if we didn't paddle hard, we would float backwards. Kobuk Valley is known for its sand dune, which is a curiosity north of the Arctic Circle. So when I set up the camera and I photograph in the park, I achieved my goal to be the first to photograph all the national parks. There was 57 back then in large format, and it was the year 2002. So my project to photograph the national parks had been self-funded. So far, back until that time, I was still working as a computer scientist. But in 2001, I set up a website. So back then, there was no Flickr, no social media, and I was hoping to be able to sell photographs through the website. Other photographers were skeptical, but eventually, thanks to a little-known search engine called Google, I was able to get some decent amount of traffic, and it allowed me to sell enough prints and license images. For a moment, Terra Galleria was the most visited of all individual photographers' websites. So in the year 2007, I was able to follow my passion and go into photography full time. It allowed me to do more repeated visits to the national parks, to cover them in different seasons, visit all their corners. I would end up doing more than 300 parks visits for that project, an average of 5 per parks. The other thing which happened in the 21st century is that digital photography took off. I bought the second full-frame camera, and it opened the door for night photography, which was so previously it wasn't possible to photograph the star field with film because film was not sensitive enough. Night photography offers even more creative possibilities than daytime photography because, in addition to all the other variables, you have the phase of the moon, and visiting the parks at night restores the sense of awe that, and mystery that sometimes was lost in crowded spots during the day. Moonlight is just like sunlight. Here is a moonset. Also, you don't see it with your naked eye. The light of moonset is warm, just like the light of sunset. Another thing which the faster shutter speed of digital made it possible was to properly capture the northern lights. To make this image, I drove on the Dalton Highway, which is one of the most dangerous roads in North America. It's 400 miles long. There's services only at one point, called Coldfoot, appropriately, population 13. At one point during the trip, at midday, the thermometer read minus 32. So another thing that I did to extend the project beyond landscape photography with a small camera is to photograph wildlife, but still I had the sensibility of a large format photographer. Instead of trying to use telephoto lenses, I tried to get closer to the animals. This is Dall Sheep in Denali National Park. So actually the way to get close to the animals is often to let them approach you. So if you stay still, they will come to you, and then you will be able to photograph them more closely, as in this image. So here's one exception when I approached the subject. This was in Zion National Park. Not your typical bird picture. It was taken with a wide-angle lens, 24 millimeter, on a tripod with a multi-second exposure. So why that long? Because it was in a dark slot canyon. To reach that spot, we had to use technical canyoneering and other skills that I learned during the project. So one of the things which is surprising in those hidden canyons is that although the temperature in the desert hovers in the hundreds, if you don't wear a wetsuit, you'd get hypothermic in no time because the water is freezing and you have to swim through. Speaking of water, here is the other half of Channel Island National Park. This is the kelp forest, the fastest growing plants on Earth. And here on the other coast, Biscayne National Park, or lowest national park, maximum elevation, 9 feet. So 95% of the park is underwater. So to photograph that, I had to scuba dive. So in underwater photography, likewise, you have to try to photograph at a close distance because otherwise the picture is not clear because of the water. And if you try to chase the fish, you will just end up photographing their tails. And the same is true also if you go snorkeling. Katmai National Park has the largest concentration of brown bears in the world. So unlike the previous animals, those they are not the ones that you want to get close to. But sometimes things happen. So maybe the bear was curious about those strange devices which are pointed to them at all the time. But fortunately for me, he was more interested in photography than having me for breakfast. So I had set up the large format camera to try to take the picture of the big footprints because you cannot use that camera to photograph the bears themselves. So I was under the dark cloth when I felt a presence behind me. Turning away, I see the bear. He was at the same distance from me as I'm from you in the front row here. So I had to remember this lesson that they teach you at the visitor center, that you have to try not to run because it triggers their hunting instinct. So I walked back slowly and made it to behind a tree. So the other thing with digital photography is that now the digital cameras double as video cameras. And so I've shown you how I extended the project beyond large format photography into wildlife and night photography. And here I'm to show you a video, another art form that I've begun to explore. But before that, I'm to explain to you what you're going to see in the video. So Hawaii Volcanoes National Park is home to Kilauea. It is the most active volcano on Earth, been erupting continuously for 40 years. And it is also the most user-friendly volcano on Earth. So there is no place like that on Earth where you can get as close and personal because the explosion is not eruptive. The lava flows very slowly. In this image was taken with a wide-angle lens. I got as close as I could to the lava before I could feel the heat burning my skin. The Haleakala crater, this image was taken in 2001. So back then you could get to the rim of the crater. In the background, you see Mauna Loa, which is a 4,000 foot mountain, despite what its rounded shape would lead you to think. It's so rounded because the lava that created it flowed very smoothly. It's called a shield volcano. Back one decade later, the volcano has reawakened, and then in the crater, there is now a lava lake. At night, you just see a plume of smoke, but when you come at day, you see a plume of smoke, but when you come at night, the lava lake illuminates that plume of smoke to create that glow. So the lava flows mostly through underground tubes to the ocean, but if you come at the right time, you can see it flowing on the surface and from time to time into the ocean. So if you want to witness that, you have to check out the National Park Service website. They have posted daily conditions because most of the time the lava doesn't flow on the surface. So when the lava hits the ocean, it creates new land right in front of you. And as it cools down, it's something that I found very moving. So as after everybody had left, I stayed overnight to create a time lapse at night. So I had a tent there because it's very rainy at that spot. So up that volcano that I showed you, Mauna Loa, it could be another planet. This was the most barren hike that I had ever done. It was 13 miles and I didn't see a single plant. And I didn't also see a single person there. It could have been another planet. I expected the top to be flat, but actually it has this huge crater with 1,600 feet vertical walls. I stayed there on the top all night in order to make a time lapse. Also, it was Hawaii. At night, my water bottle froze. Here's a video. Video is great, but it still remains in the digital realm. And for me, it's very important to have a physical manifestation of the photograph because there's so much more resolution in the print, and viewing things in the world is different than looking at a computer screen. So I mounted a travel exhibit which traveled across the country. Here's an installation at the Boston Museum of Science. It was viewed maybe by hundreds of thousands, but exhibits still come and go. On the other hand, book stays and can inspire generations. So the year 2016 marked the 100th anniversary of the National Park Service. I wanted to celebrate the occasion by releasing my own book. So book Travel Through the Ages, indeed, I was inspired by a 100-year-old book, which is called The National Parks Portfolio. It was the main tool that Stephen Mather used to lobby for the creation of the National Park Service in 1916. Also, it says Department of the Interior on the cover. He funded the first printing out of his own pocket. So Stephen Mather would go on to become the first director of the National Park Service. The book was called The National Park Portfolio because it consisted of 9 booklets, one for each of the national parks. The first characteristic of the portfolio that struck me was that it provided a very complete description of each park. So here's Stephen Mather's own assessment. At that time, there were just 9 national parks, so that was something which was fairly easy to do. Now it is much more of a challenge. The second characteristic of the portfolio that struck me was that it was an invitation to visit the park. So you see how to reach the national parks, and this very emphatic Yosemite belongs to you. So inspired by those two characteristics, I wanted to make a book about the national park which would be very comprehensive and which also would be an invitation to visit. So here is some specifications from my book proposal. No traditional publisher wanted to take on that project because it was too ambitious. So by the summer of 2015, no progress had been made, and so I decided to try to do it by myself. I hired a publishing consultant. 2 months after, the consultant quit because he saw that the project was too risky. So I'm to show you the vision that I had for the book. So of course it would cover all the national parks, but it would also give equal weight to the lesser gems than to the more well-known national parks. And I will give you an example a bit later. So for each park, I also wanted to cover it in detail to give justice not only to the diversity found in the national park system, but also to the diversity found in each park. So the example that I'll give you is from Lassen Volcanic National Park. It is always a place where I can go in the summer when I'm looking for an uncrowded outing to a national park. I can find there the beautiful landscape of the Sierra, but at the same time, Lassen has a vast array of geological features. So it is the only national park that has the 4 types of volcanoes. So also, so it's 10 images from Lassen Volcanic National Park. This is the summit of Mount Lassen. It bears the scars of the 20th century eruption. Here you see a plugged dome volcano above Hidden Lake. And here that's a composite volcano against above Reflection Lake, basalt cliffs giving rise to Kings Creek Falls, and a shield volcano against Juniper Lake. Last, the cinder cone that we've seen before, and at Bumpass Hill, a geothermal area which looks like a mini Yellowstone, and there at David's Kitchen, another geothermal area which is much less developed. So the images not only would tell a natural history story, but also you can see on the map that each of them was chosen to represent a specific location on the park. And together, they cover all the 5 entrances of the park. So other photography books, coffee table books, they can inspire you with beautiful photography, but often they leave you wondering where the locations are. So the treasured land, I wanted for each image to provide a paragraph of text that explains in detail where is the location, how to get there, what is the best time of the day of the year, and maybe from time to time some photography tips or some of my own experiences. So many in the publishing industry were very skeptical, but by using a hybrid publishing model between self-publishing and traditional publishing, I was eventually able to realize my vision. and offer the book for a very reasonable price for what you get. So Treasured Lands is my opus magnum. I set up to create the best photography book about the national park. So have I succeeded? So I'll let you the judge, but I'll only say that 1 year after publication, the book went into its third printing. So I'm going to conclude here with the section of Yosemite from the book and the idea that even in the most well-trodden places, there's still something new to discover. So on the right, the tunnel view that all of you know. On the left, a view that I bet you haven't seen before. So where is that view? If you look at the valley view there, on the left, there is a waterfall very high there. This waterfall is called Ribbon Falls. It is the tallest one drop waterfall in North America, 1,600 feet. Yosemite Falls is higher, but it has 3 tiers. And there's a user trail that leads you to the base of that waterfall. You can stand in a huge amphitheater where the water drops directly on your head. It is a very awesome and very cold experience. Speaking of Yosemite Falls, even for a very well-known landmark, there's still something new to discover. Most photographers and visitors stop at the bridge, but if you continue maybe 10 minutes past it on the talus field, you come to this viewpoint where you see upper falls and lower falls in alignment. So the picture was made at night. It is a moon bow, a rainbow created by the full moon. This spot is exceedingly wet in the spring. To make this image, I had to use a special device that rotates very fast to throw out water off the lens. So I'm going to conclude by saying that I'm hoping that this presentation has given you a taste of the diversity found in the national park. So, exploring the national parks has been an incredible adventure for me. It has brought much joy to my life, and my hope is that you can experience for yourself the joy that I experience in the park. So the National Park Service has 2 goals. One is to conserve the lands for future generations. The other is to make it enjoyable for present generations. They have made a very good job at accommodating those 2 objectives. So everything that you saw there is there for you and belongs to you. You don't have to lug a heavy camera. You don't even have to venture very far from the road. So above all, I hope that my photography has inspired you to visit your park for yourself. And if the experience has enriched your life, to do something in turn for your national parks. And I thank you in advance for that. Okay, so I think we have time for a few questions, if you'd like.
Thanks for the great presentation. I'm down to 19 parks, so yeah, you beat me for sure.
Thank you.
I hope to cover all the parks at some point in time. So two-part question. One is, what kind of post-processing do you do of these images? And now that with the digital camera, full-frame cameras, are you inclined more to take full-frame pictures with a digital camera versus the traditional ones? What are the pros and cons?
Sure. So post-processing in case of the film images, the post-processing that I do is mostly to try to match the transparency. So the transparency is a transmissive medium. The light goes through it. The print is a reflective medium. So they have different characteristics. And so I try to match the experience of looking at the transparency in the print. So in order to do that, I do some minor adjustments. In general, I I do not do radical post-processing. Of course, when I shoot with digital, I use RAW, and then you have to process the file to bring out the color and the contrast. But in general, that's pretty much the adjustments that I do. So local adjustments of color and contrast. As for the digital versus large format photography, so when I started the project, if you wanted high resolution, there was no alternative to large format. Now, of course, digital give you very good quality in a very small package. And so now these days, I actually do most of my photography in digital. But in the book, I would say it's about half and half.
Hi. My five-year-old has done 12 parks, so I'm hoping she'll get to all the 59 in good time. One of the things I was very curious to know is you've seen the art form emerge from traditional film into digital. While we all see the quality of pictures change along with it, how has the experience in national parks changed now with more digital photographers out there, more people wanting to experience national parks? Have you seen like a significant change in how the national parks themselves have evolved to handle that?
Yes, I would say that photography has definitively become more popular with digital photography, and now some of the spots that I photographed in the 90s, I was either the only photographer there, or there were just a couple of them. Spots like, for instance, the Mesa Arch in Canyonlands. I've been told that now, if you want to stake a spot, you have to come several hours before sunrise, and in general there will be a crowd of several dozen. So indeed, I would say that some of the more popular spots have become more crowded. There's no denying it. But I've been trying as of late to explore mostly in the backcountry of the parks. And the thing that I found is that if you go further than maybe 1 hour from the trailhead, you know, the parks remain largely uncrowded. And if you go further than that and you go into lesser known areas, which some of which I've tried to feature in the book to give you some ideas, then you can really have the place for yourself.
So a question online, how do you decide to go to a particular national park?
Yeah, that's actually my question too. So for example, like I guess say for example you might want to visit a national park for a particular season, right? But then what exactly days do you pick? Do you look at the weather forecast and things like that before deciding, okay, I should go now or I should go next week?
So in general on the trips, actually, I try to visit more than one park. With some exceptions, it's not last-minute planning. So I pick the time more based on the season. I'd say, for instance, you know, the autumn or the spring, and then after that, yeah, I can delay my trip on, I'd say by a few days, or choose to visit the parks in a different order according to the weather. And for instance, if I see that it's going to be cloudy, then I'm going to go to somewhere where I'm going to photograph in the forest or something. Or conversely, if I see that there will be no cloud, then I'm going to plan to do some night photography, for instance. So I stay flexible when I get to the location, but it's the long-term planning, I would say, which is more important.
I have a question. So I noticed that you started to use drones. Could you talk about how that changes things?
Well, for one thing, drones are prohibited in national parks. So I haven't done any drone photography in the national park for that reason. But for my other projects, I've indeed taken to them, and I think they're really great because they afford you to do aerial photography on the spur of a moment, so you don't have to do advanced planning and book a flight, and it is of course much less expensive, and then it really allows you to have a new perspective on the land, which I think is great.
So it sounds like you've been doing this now, the National Parks Project, for about 25 years, if I give or take from 92. So I know you also mentioned more lately you've been going to backcountry. So I was curious if you've kind of worked on a project of continuity at all, or is it more just trying to document as much as possible, or have you found yourself even season to season going back to the same spots and trying to capture a lot of the same images? And then as a second part to that, if you've noticed any changes in those spots over the last 25 years?
Yeah, the thing that I do actually when I return to a park, I always try to find something new. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, you know, I saw that the project would stop at one point, but the thing is that the more you know something, the more you realize that there's something that you don't know. And so I've been exploring, I would say, new corners of the park that I hadn't seen before, or new conditions, rather than trying to return repeatedly to the same spot. But still, you know, it's I did from time to time return to the same spot. For instance, to Exit Glacier, where I've gone there four times. And each time, you know, what really struck me was the glacial retreat. So the first time when I got there, I was able to get to the edge of the glacier. Now the glacier has retreated hundreds of yards, and then there's a new valley that appeared, which is very steep, and you can't get closer, for instance. So those changes are the most striking that I've seen.
Cool. Which one is your favorite national park?
So that would be a question which would be difficult to answer just based on the merits of the park, because they are also different. But for me, it's an easy question to answer if I answer it based on my relationship with the place. And so it has to be Yosemite, because it was the first place that I visited. It's a park that I visited more than any others. I've done probably hundreds of visits in that park alone. I've climbed, skied, hiked in the park in all seasons. So I've really developed a relationship with the place.
If you were to think back, actually, let me rephrase the question. If somebody were to do this, you know, visit all the national parks and take pictures, what would your advice to them be? And on reflection, what would you do differently?
So if someone was to visit all the national parks, my advice would be that don't get ready to do a single trip and expect to a park and expect to see everything. So there's quite a few folks, particularly during the centennial, they embark on a trip where their goal was to visit all the parks in a year or something like that. And I mean, it's something which is fun to do, but actually, you know, you on a single visit, you see only one aspect of the park. And I personally prefer, you know, to come back to a park several times rather than making a long visit. So that would be one advice I would give. What was the second part of the question?
On reflection, what would you do differently?
Oh, what would I do differently? Yes, what I would do differently is that I would take a much more systematic approach to photography in the national parks, in the sense that in the course of a project, I noticed that there's a number of sub-themes that began to develop that I haven't showed you in this presentation. So I began to zero in on some specific aspect of the parks, the trees, close up of the grounds, the night sky, even grains of sand. And so I found that because I didn't begin to photograph those subjects on my first visits. Even some parks after I'd done three or four visits, I still had to return to complete those series. So it's something that I would have thought better from the beginning.
Okay, well, thank you for coming.